for my salvation. Amen. Would you please be seated? I take a week off and I miss all my cues. I step on Lynn's opening hymn there and I forgot to announce that Sunday school can now go off. Dr. Kathy, they didn't want to say, but my chant, DeVay, and Sean. I'm going to go one of these days. See, folks, this is why I have to keep writing things down. I'm never going to remember. I want to talk to you this morning about our Old Testament lesson. In fact, I'm going to preach on a particular passage. And it's from Exodus. It's on the first page of our green insert. And it's, but the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Now, before I get to that passage, I've got to sort of take a roundabout approach. I've never done that before. And I'm going to take you back to December, I think it was 20th, 2014. There was a bishop in Maryland, a woman named Heather Cook, one of the few female bishops of the Episcopal Church, one of the leaders in the movement for women priests. And she had become a woman bishop, and she was attending a Christmas party on a Saturday afternoon. And after the party, she was headed over to a church, because the next Sunday, she was going to preach. And she had been having a good time at this party, and she had been drinking. And she was driving through Baltimore, and she was texting on her phone as she was driving to let them know that she was going to be a little late. And she came upon a group of bicyclists, and all these men dressed with the little silver helmets and suits and the expensive bicycles, and she knocked one of them over, and he hit, rolled over the roof, hit her windshield, and he fell onto the ground. She stopped, and then she sped off. She came back an hour later and was arrested. The man had died. She was breathalyzed, and she was over the limit of alcohol. This incident had a profound effect on the life. The man was 37 years old. He had several young children. His life in front of him had a profound effect upon that man and his family. And it also had a profound effect upon the Episcopal Church. For at the General Convention the following summer, we did something different. For about 30 years, we have been fighting over the same issues. We decided to talk about something else. And one of those was substance abuse. Alcohol abuse, drug abuse, pornography, gambling, addictions. Now the church has gone back and forth on addictions. And it historically had been, you're just weak. Snap out of it. If you really wanted to, you could stop. That had been a traditional viewpoint. But in 1956, the American Medical Association said that alcoholism is not a moral failure. It's a disease. And the church began to, because the church is not a scientific body, it takes its cues on medicine and science from the scientific community, and the church began to change its views on alcohol abuse, such that we reach the opposite side, which is they can't help themselves. And after the man who was the Bishop of Baltimore, Bishop of Maryland, a man named Gene Summer, he was the odds on favorite to be the next presiding bishop. This was somebody young, dynamic, had silver tongue. He was just, and he was nice to everybody. This was one of those few people where everybody liked him in the Episcopal Church. But what happened? He had saw no evil. The night before this woman was ordained a bishop, they had a party, and she passed out at the party. And he was a little concerned, and he called the presiding bishop and said, I think we have a problem. Heather has passed out. Is this something that we should be concerned about? And the presiding bishop responded, no, she's gotten this far, and I'm sure she didn't mean to. Well, after her arrest, it turned out that she had a drunk driving arrest 3 years earlier. And it never came up when they did the search for her because that's not a moral failing. She has an illness. And so the church had gone from, this is moral failing, if you're a drunk, you can't be a priest, to, this is a problem that if you get treatment for, it doesn't matter. It's not like you're stuck up a bank or something. The church would go back and forth, back and forth. And so the General Convention in 2015, the church sat down to discuss, what do we really think about addiction? Can you help it? Is it a moral failing? Now, we're Episcopalians, what do we decide? Both! But we started first with the Bible. How, what, you start with the Bible before you talk about alcoholism? Yes, you do. First, we read the Bible and we're not Baptists. We drink alcohol. We don't think it's a sin. Jesus changed water into wine, not grape juice. We dance, we play cards. Somebody even chews tobacco. And they're not going to go to hell for that. The church, our church, has always taught alcohol is not wrong. The abuse of alcohol is the problem. Sex is a gift from God. Adultery is the sin. Fornication is the sin, not the gift of human sexuality. It's the abuse of it. But we began to sit down, and one of the readings we looked at was this passage from Exodus. Oh, wait. You remember this from the movie, don't you? I don't remember any AA meetings after watching the Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston and Yul Brynner. What's going on here? Well, let's look at the Bible passage and put all this in context and see how the Bible is speaking to us today. This is more than just a good optics for the Old Testament. This is one of the beloved passages that Sunday school kids love, that TV, television, movies make into films, because it's visual, it's exciting. But there's a theological meaning here that's so much deeper and profound, greater than special effects. Let me give you the background, and it may help if you follow the movie, because the movie was pretty close to read the book. Pharaoh has oppressed the Israelite people, and Moses has been sent by God to lead them out of captivity. And Pharaoh's refused. Last week we would have had the plagues of Egypt if we were here in our readings. Now the plagues are over. Pharaoh has said, you may go. And Pharaoh is upset. Not that, oh baby, don't leave! Not that sort of upset. But you people have embarrassed me, humiliated me, you have made my gods look stupid, you have made the king, the Pharaoh, look foolish. As soon as the Israelites are out of town, he unleashes the army. Kill them all. Kill them all. And the Israelites have reached the Red Sea. They're between the devil and the deep blue sea at this point. There's the water. Pharaoh's army is approaching. And Pharaoh has sent the highest technology he has. He has sent his chariots. Pharaoh's army, the chariots were the tanks of the ancient Near East. Only the most powerful, these were the weapons that won battles. And who are they going to war against? A bunch of Jews with their horses and donkeys and household goods. No soldiers here. They're sending the tanks out. Crush the peasants. Now, leading the Israelites across the wilderness of sin has been a column of fire. That's where they knew to go, where to go. They followed this column. And our reading starts off with the column moving from the front, the fire, moving from the front to the rear. And Pharaoh and his armies see this column of smoke and darkness, and night is falling. But on the Israelite side, light, the column is sending forth light. This is the angel of the Lord. So there's a temporary, if you remember the film, there's a temporary eclipse or blockage or something is preventing Pharaoh from seeing that they don't know what's going on. And God says to Moses, stretch out your hand. And here, and Moses stretches out his hands, and the Bible says God used the forces of nature to save his people. No magic here. God sent winds to push the water and dry the land. If you were watching TV last week, you saw Tampa Bay empty. Why was it empty? The hurricane winds pushed the water out and it was all sucked out. Now God's miracle was like that, but we had two winds because we had a pathway with the water sucked this way and that way, the dry land between. The Israelites escape across, and as they're over there, the column of fire is lifted. Pharaoh and his army sees the fleeing Israelites, and they charge! But their chariot wheels get clogged. The sand is strong enough for people to walk on, for horses to walk on, but not for heavy chariots, not for our men in armor to get across. And the last Israelite gets across. God says, raise your hand. Winds stop, and the waters close over the Egyptians. And they know it's not a dream because they see the dead bodies of the Egyptians on the banks. God has made a miracle. Well, what has this got to do with AA and alcohol? This has got everything to do with it because the Israelites walked on the dry ground through the sea. Have there been times in your life when you've called on God, God, I need a miracle! God, help me! Change my life! Change this world! And you don't hear anything back. God has answered the Israelites' prayer. But then God called upon the Israelites to walk. What does this mean? You play your part in your salvation. God did not pick the Israelites off the coast of Egypt and plop them down in Sinai. They had to walk while the waters were held. They had a choice. They could have stayed where they were, or they could have sat down in the middle of the Red Sea and said, oh, this is just not going to work, and been drowned with the Egyptians. But God may gave them the opportunity to be saved. God is not a magician here. He doesn't work against us in our own salvation. If you choose damnation, if you choose to do nothing, guess what, folks? You're going to be dead. You're going to lose it all. But if you walk in faith, you will reach the other side. Now, what has this got to do with what we're talking about earlier? And, you know, we sort of joke, we're Episcopalians, we say, oh, both. Well, we're not scientists. Our general convention is not a medical body. We don't understand how these things work. But we do know that alcohol abuse, that pornography, drug abuse, they rewire your neural pathways. If you abuse alcohol, your brain changes. And it's that much harder for you to stop. One of the saddest, most destructive things are the children of our society today can get on the internet and they can look at any sort of filth they want. I mean, when I was a teenage boy, to get a dirty magazine was a chore. You had to find somebody, it was like buying alcohol, you had to find somebody who was 21 years old. You could buy beer, but you couldn't buy pornography. You had to find somebody old enough to go to the dirty bookstore and buy it, and then take it home, and then hide it. Well, you have experience in this. Okay. Ron, I'll let you take over from this point. Nowadays, anybody, any age, can just flip on and see disgusting degradation. And what is so sad is that there are so many young people, young boy, I'm talking 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds, 12-year-olds, who are thinking this is what sexual relations are. Girls are objects, they're things. They're being warped. And you know, the scientists tell us this is rewiring their neural pathways. It's the same with alcohol. I know a bishop who has a problem with alcohol. An Episcopal bishop, different bishop. He hasn't been arrested yet. And he would embarrass the hell out of me by calling me every so often at 1 in the morning when he was bombed. And I would call him, thinking, oh, please God, may he pass out soon so I can put his phone down. And he'd get up the next day and preach a whiz bang the sermon, but alcohol was destroying his life inside. He was responding to the stress of his job, to the stress of his life. He had a bad son. His church was falling apart around him. He was one of the stalwarts of the faith. But he medicated himself by going into his room, shut the door, drinking, and then calling priests to complain about the Episcopal Church. Have you been under stress this past week? I've been under tremendous stress, unlucky. I've never been a drinker, never. I mean, I drink alcohol. I don't have any moral views on it one way or the other, but it's just not me. I'll have a glass of beer from time to time. I've got no problem with alcohol. Gambling, I find incredibly dull. I'd go to Las Vegas and I'd be the guy watching the floor shows all day, waiting for my wife to finish at the slot machines. It's just not my thing. But you know what I do? When I'm stressed, what did I do immediately after the storm was over? I went and I got a pizza. And I know people who went over to the ABC liquor store. No names. The one in Crystal River has been open already. People respond to stress through stimuli. And me, I've tried every diet. I can tell you which ones work. I've tried the Atkins, I've tried the watermelon, I've tried the high carb, low carb, this carb, that carb. And you know what? None of them work for me. Do you know why? Because I don't stay with it. My bishop friend told me the best time of the day when he was drinking was the moment before he took his first drink. Because after that first drink, second drink, third drink, it never got worse. Joy, pleasure, kick, the buzz. So that by the time he was down to that bottom of the golf bottle, he hated himself. Because he knew what he was doing. Does he have a disease? Yes, I'm sure his neural pathways are wired badly. But he has to walk just like I have. Cross that part of the sea. God is not going to move that glass 6 inches out of your reach. You have a choice whether or not to take it. I had a choice whether or not I got terrible cholesterol, I got high blood pressure, I'm going to get diabetes, so I know I should not go out and buy a pizza. But I did. I had a choice to make. See, when we say as a church that addictions and abuse are a combination of illness and moral failing, we're not trying to be clever or cute, we're saying it's both. When you start on that treadmill, there are forces, medical, psychological, that will continue pushing you down that hill. But until you choose to stop, you're not going to stop. The AMA's changing of definition of alcoholism was a good thing because all of a sudden insurance companies would pay for treatment for alcoholism. They pay for treatment of, when it's medicalized, it's covered by insurance. But the downside is that people push responsibility away. I can't help myself. And what we say as a church is, yes, it's not easy. It's not hard. It's hard. You're gonna fall down. opportunity to pull your hand back from that bottle. One of the things we as a church did was we passed rules. Vestry meetings may no longer serve alcohol. I know, Betty, that was a big shocker for us on the but it certainly speeded up things because we all want to get home. We've adopted policies. We no longer have, if we have alcohol, we must have alternative beverages. If somebody gets bombed, guess who's got to drive them home? Ron, that's your job this week. No, in other words, we have protocols in place because we need to realize that addictions kill people. But God gives us the strength and the choice to say no. At the end of the day, salvation is your choice too. You can accept Jesus Christ, or you can say no. You can sit in the middle on your haunches in the Red Sea, thinking, you know, this stuff doesn't work. I'm just going to wait. And you will be overwhelmed by the Red Sea when it closes on the army of Pharaoh. Get up, walk, and you will reach the other side if that walk is accompanied by faith. You don't have the strength and self-will and determination by yourself to do it. If you do, God bless you. I don't have the strength. If I rely upon Jesus Christ, if I rely upon the power of God, He will help me, and I will get to the other side. Amen. Amen. Friends, would you please stand and join with me in saying,